bloody foam, Venus arises. And you've all, if we may not see the image, you've all seen, you know, the Venus on the half shell, right? That, the classical image. There are also lots of images of Venus riding a dolphin coming up. In the Vedic tradition, it's a somewhat similar, although different, in that Cupid or Eros in Sanskrit is called Kamadev. Kamadev was the son of Brahma, and Sati originally employed him to sort of disturb Shiva and get him interested in her. So Shiva's always like meditating all the time, right? And he gets this disturbance in his consciousness, and he looks out, and there's this young, you know, impish god instilling him with desire, and Sati's sitting over there. And it works that time. Sati and Shiva mess around for a while until Sati self-immolates. And we'll come back to that in a little ways down the road. And then we have Sati's dead, and Parvati, who is the daughter of the Himalaya, Himalaya was her father, and also gets interested in Shiva. She does all this tapas to gain Shiva's favor. He still doesn't come out of the meditation, right? So she gets Kamadev, or Cupid, Eros, to come and disturb Shiva's meditation. Well, this is the second time this has happened, right? And so Shiva's known as the destroyer. He opens his eyes and he's furious, and he looks at Kamadev and vaporizes him. Doesn't even turn him into ashes, just vaporizes him. So now Eros is everywhere. Kamadev is everywhere. In fact, Shiva takes on the name of Kamadev, right? Because Shiva, the consciousness is everywhere, and the erotic desire is everywhere. Everywhere in nature, everywhere in the universe. Parvati, however, succeeds in having intercourse with Shiva, or perhaps perpetually in perhaps different bodies. So we have the most commonly formed, our form of worship in India, in the non-Vaishnavite tradition, is the Shaivite lingam and yoni. You've seen that before? We don't have the picture, so hopefully, we might have the picture, I don't have it yet. So, basically, it's sex. I mean, that's what they're worshipping, right? And they pour 5 sacred substances on it that sort of look as, you know, milk and honey and yogurt and other white things that sort of look like semen, you know, coming out of the penis into the vagina, a vulva, and it pours out and drips down. And then you get some of that as the nectar, amrit, from the puja. You got it?
No.
Justine.
No.
Can you come?
Oh. Help from the audience. So this is one of the central rituals in India. Is worshipping the mother and father in the middle of union. And indeed, at one point, Shiva was sort of a naked ascetic. He's wandering around. He goes into some of these conservative towns in the Midwest, in the United States, and the community gets mad at him for walking around, wagging his penis around with, you know, since they got mad at him, he just drops it. At which time, all of creation stops flowering.
And your finger.
Oh, sorry.
Thank you.
So, okay. So, the erotic impulse is our love, our desire, is what not only makes the world around, but makes the world. if it wasn't for, you know, the desire of elements for one another, of matter for one another, there would be no manifest reality. So keeping desire and also keeping the creative process flowing is a huge part of at least Indian religion. In the West, they tend to get a little more puritanical, maybe not so much in Italy, but in other parts, you know, they get very, you know, they're into chastity and celibacy and stuff. Of course, they don't tell you that if you're really mystic, that, you know, the nuns are considered the bride of Christ. And if you're, Teresa of Avila, if she wrote about this, would have certainly been burned by the Inquisition. But she had the experience, and all the spiritual counselors know in the Catholic Church that deal with these women are men. And actually happens to men, too, that they literally have sex with Jesus. So they have the mystical experience of having sex with Jesus. I know some of these women, and their counselors are perfectly fine with this mystical sexual union. So the whole idea of the union of the individual soul and the cosmic soul is central both in East and West. Right? So, this takes us to the whole idea of our own sexuality. So that's the mythic component. But almost all creative process is based on some, Freud would say, transformation of libido. Jung had texts about that as well. What we know is that the earliest poets were considered quite erotic. Indeed, Sappho was considered the ideal of eroticism. And if you read Sapphic poetry, it still is really hot today. I mean, her descriptions of desire and having, you know, the Eros or cupidity come upon her, how she shakes and how she longs for her partner are quite magnificent. Catullus named his muse Lesbia in honor of Sappho. Right? So desire, whether it's between sexes or for the same sex, is considered poetic or creative. The creative impulse, the creative impulse is not only the essence of our most intimate experiences in terms of emotional intimacy, bonding to one another, but it's essential to our spirituality and becoming fully developed individuals. So Eric Erickson talks about stages of development, and we have the traditional Freudian stages, and then you have something called intimacy, right? Versus isolation, which is where you first get into the idea of sexual relationship or being able to develop your personality through erotic attachment. That progresses into having families and communities. However, the next stage he calls generativity, and that is having creativity or desire or relationship with your community. Right? And in Buddhist tradition, that's called being a bodhisattva, right? Where you actually have the inner desire to sort of, and you actually long for your community. I think we had a presentation where they had the Buddhist monk burning himself, but his heart didn't burn, right? Because of his heartfelt desire to help the community, right? He had a sacred or a parapsychologically special heart, right? But it was untouched by flames, still fresh. The psyche continues to progress, and from bodhisattva, you get further development of the personality into non-duality, which is a merging of the individual consciousness into either universal consciousness or the maintaining of individual consciousness in a dualistic mode, while also merging with the divine. So you actually become a lover of the divine or a bride of Christ or whatever your tradition is. So they continue, even if you are in non-duality, you can still have a dualistic experience, and it's an erotic experience. It's actually like having sex 24/7. So the experience of Kundalini awakening is similar to the individual consciousness, almost like a sperm uniting with the egg of cosmic awareness, right? The cosmos. And it becomes one and creates a new deity or God. Right? So the individual Kundalini rises. It is a physical orgasm. If you've had a Kundalini experience, it rises, it shakes the whole body, it's totally blissful. Comes out as a whole, entire bodily orgasm, and you unite not with your partner, which can also happen, we'll talk about that, but you unite with the universe, with everything. It's working?
No.
Okay. So that's the framework. So how do we get there? And we've had some discussion about how to present engage in lovemaking. A few presentations on that. How to make love with one another, whether sexually or not sexually. So I'm going to talk about the Taoist and the Tantric approaches. So the Taoist approach is a simple approach. It doesn't require a lot of rituals. You don't have to know all the mudras. You don't have to offer, you know, all these flowers and do all this sort of stuff before you actually have sex. And you don't have to chant mantras while you're having sex. The Taoists have been practicing in a very simple Chinese fashion without all that stuff, very practical. Basically, the idea is what's called the microcosmic orbit. So there's qi, or breath, and then there's qing, or sexual energy, or vital energy, as they would call it. And they cultivate the breath with breathing to dhara. They practice it with or without a partner every day. It's used in Tai Chi, the karate, you know, the martial arts, karate, judo, all those things. They breathe the dhara. The idea is to circulate the energy from the gonads, from the sexual organs, up the spine to the chakras, basically on the back of the spine, around the head, down the nose, into the mouth, down the front of the body, and back into the sexual organs. And of course, that's generally done with a partner. And both partners do this. It's not like it's, you know, this is what the man does. No, this is what the woman does too. So they have the microcosmic orbits where they're circulating the energy. Once they're aroused, once the energy is aroused, then they breathe it up the spine, and you can feel it come up the spine. Then you guide it through, over the head, through the channels, down through the nose, through the lips. They often put the tongue to the top of the mouth to bring it through, down through the neck, to through the throat chakra, heart chakra, you know, Manipura, and then back to the Svadhisthana, the sexual chakra. Then you start over again, and you keep circulating the energy. And they prescribe all kinds of practices with this, how many strokes, for how long, and what on one side or the other, or, you know, from the front or the back. It's very detailed. Indeed, some people, some Taoists, some traditional Chinese medicine folks describe Taoism as sexual medicine, pure and simple. They actually prescribe sex for different illnesses in different ways. And this is all written, it's very easy to find this stuff. There are a couple of Dr. Changs that write about it. There's this fellow Montauk Chia and his wife, who's a Thai Kung Fu martial artist master. And he has one for men, his wife has one for women. Their proteges have written a book called Sexual Secrets, where they document all these different things in great detail, which it's basically an encyclopedia of this kind of thing. And they also go into the tantric approaches as well, which I'll deal with in a moment. So the simple part is the circulation of the qing, or sexual energy. So the orgasm goes around you. For the man, you don't go all the way over the top. So it's 90, they say, the Taoists say 99% times 10 is way more than 100% times 1. So they go all the way to practically that point of no return, and they hold with the breath, and they circulate that energy around. And then when it starts to come down, they get excited again, and they do the same thing over and over. It's a very energizing way to have sex for the male. And the female does the same thing, right? And, however, the female really doesn't need a partner.
No.
The women can do this without a partner just as well, and no imbalances occur. However, for men, if they don't have the yin energy, they get yanged out. They get too stressed, too much heavy, dark energy accumulates, and they'll get ill from that. So they need the woman. The woman doesn't need the man, right? Because the yin can expand and has no detrimental qualities. So masturbation for women is like, you know, it's great, right? They prescribe, you know, sex with or without a partner for various illnesses. It's a gender difference. I know gender is a little passé these days, at least in the Bay Area, but but it's, you know, at least in traditional Chinese medicine or Taoism, that's what happens. And Montauk Chia talks about developing the iron shirt body, which means that essentially it's hard to destroy. So if they get hit by somebody, you know, who's an expert martial artist, it doesn't hurt them. The bones don't break. They can put their hands through, you know, bricks or stones. The bones of the hands don't break. They become, they get bodies of iron. My name's Eyerman. I often tell people I'm an Iron Man. I don't think I've progressed that far. However, there are a number of people that can demonstrate that, right? And they do all the time. I was just with Stan Grof a couple weeks ago, and you know, two guys driving around, and all of a sudden we're talking about penises and sex and all that sort of stuff. And he was talking about his experience in China recently, where, you know, the university chair of the psychiatry department was really going out on a limb to come to holotropic breathwork, you know, because it's sort of like really avant-garde and stuff, and he's very traditional. But then Stan went to this party at the Taoist club with the professor, and the first thing the professor did was take off all his clothes, climb on a couple blocks, and wrap his penis with cloth, and hang like 80 pounds of weight from his penis, and swing it around. this sounds very bizarre, but actually in Chinatowns you will see men pulling freight cars with their penis down the road backwards, right? So there's this development of a sexual power that is actually physical as well as subtle, and it's, you know, they develop this iron body and they demonstrate it by these procedures, and it's extremely sexual. Now that doesn't have a lot to do with Eros, right? But it does have to do with sex, which is part of Eros, right? And they're developing their sexual prowess. They're showing what a strong set of genitals they have. It's like, well, all right. The woman may have other practices than just masturbation. They do something called the deer technique, which is also done in traditional yoga. They call it the breath of fire, Kapalabhati, and they do it with diaphragmatic breathing, and they try to get the pelvic diaphragm going back and forth as the main source of the breath, and that's the abdominal diaphragm. So breathing with the pelvic diaphragm is essentially the deer technique, right? And it's basically kegeling, if you know what that means. So kegeling, Kegel was a, yes, you know Kegel. Kegel was a doctor, obstetrician, who taught women after the first baby how to tighten the vagina and tighten the muscles that might have been torn. All right. So after they're healed, then you practice kegeling or pulling up the perineum to develop better pelvic floor tone, better vaginal tone. You know, then it's better for your partner, better for your own orgasm, because the tone of the muscle of the perineum does determine somewhat your I don't know whether we're getting anywhere. Determines the some of the quality of your orgasm, right? How well the energy moves. Right? I was medical director at Masters & Johnson for 4 years in the 90s. I don't know if you've seen Masters of Sex, and it wasn't like that at all. they were very clinical and very scientific. They did pass around this plastic penis with a light in it and all that sort of stuff. And we saw, before the internet, this was pretty much before internet porn, we would have Masters of Johnson porn, you know, various couples having sex, you know, the inside of the vagina being shown, you know, lubricating, all this sort of stuff with this material. So they developed all these techniques to delay orgasm or to promote orgasm, and they were essentially the same kind of techniques, you know, pelvic exercises, kegeling, different hold techniques on the penis to hold the orgasm so people wouldn't have premature orgasm, different ways of fantasizing to bring people into arousal. The biggest technique was paradoxical, which was if you had trouble with your libido, then you weren't supposed to have sex. You were supposed to go home and practice nurturing one another naked. So, and then when you took the whole demand to perform off, people seemed not to be able to follow the exercise. So they would follow through with getting aroused and having sex and come back and say, oh, I'm so sorry, you know, we couldn't do it. But that was the point of the exercise. In other words, it was very Ericksonian or paradoxical. If you've ever dealt with adolescents, well, one thing you don't want to tell them to do is what to do. You tell them what not to do, right? And then you tell them to go do it. And then say, no, I'm not going to do that, right? So then you get them to do what you want them to do. Right? So paradoxical therapy works well in sexual disorders. It works well with adolescents. It just works well. And with adults too. So the best way to have a good lover is not to try to have a good lover or be a good lover. Best way is just to relax and enjoy the other person and let nature take its course and enjoy the course of nature. enjoy the arousal. So, and it'll do its own thing, because it has its own wisdom. Right? Before we thought about things, before we developed, you know, the cerebral cortex, we were all having sex a lot, you know, as monkeys, various other life forms, you know, alligators, and snakes, and frogs, for quite a while, right? Before we ever got to think about it. Right? Even though the fantasies help, but actually the performance is below the tentorium. It's all below the thinking level. So not thinking about sex is the best way to have sex, paradoxically. So in other words, the less intelligent you are and caught in your mind, the better you are as a lover. That's why poets who are not caught in rational thinking, but are more symbolic, are thought to be very erotic and often, you know, have multiple lovers and things like that. So the Taoist approach is very simple. It has the cultivation of the energy. For the men, they delay it. There's also something called, I don't remember the Chinese name, it's probably on my slides if we get there, but we call it the $1 million point in English, which is where the urethra goes into the perineum, the perineal floor. And so that where that goes into the perineum, then if pressure is applied there, the finger would go right up into the prostate, and you can do an internal prostate massage. As guys get older, they need to have their prostate massaged, or they get prostate problems, and they have to have, you know, some type of surgery type thing because they can't pee, right? So, this $1 million point helps prostate massage, but it also will block ejaculation. They call it dry ejaculation. So there's no sperm coming out. It's saved, which means the next time, if they want to have sex again shortly, they can. Doesn't matter how old they are, the delay time is more like a teenager, you know. So, you know, 67-year-old guys, 70-year-old guys, 80-year-old guys can have sex in another 20, 30 minutes, whereas some 40-year-old guy that doesn't practice this might have a latency period of several hours. Right? So it's very practical from one point of view. From the Taoist point of view, the fluids that are retained, so the prostate gets squeezed to get to push out, you know, fluids for the sperm to be bathed in as it comes out in ejaculation. All that gets sort of blocked and squeezed and pushed into the bloodstream. So you get more sexual fluids or sexual hormones floating around in the blood. And that's part of what's thought to convey longevity, right? So you get, then one of the things that Taoists are known for is being immortal. Not that they're really immortal, but there's some guys that are supposed to be 800 years old or several hundred years old. I met one yogi who doesn't do these things, but who was 450 years old, and by rumor, but the vice president of India came to see him because he was, you know, been around for a while. Grandparents, you know, when they were children, said their grandparents said that he was an old man when they were, I mean, he went back generations. So people can live to very long ages, and the Taoists have perfected this type of thing of using the sexual energy to revitalize all the organs and the entire physiology. So that's Taoist Medicine 101. And it also promotes this $1 million point is called $1 million not only because it creates longevity and the ability to have sex again in a half an hour or whatever, but it also increases the length and intensity of the male orgasm. So rather than just, you know, 15 seconds or 20 seconds, it can go on for minutes. Right? If either the man himself or the woman or whatever partner is holding that spot for them, they can continue to have orgasm without release like some women. So some women can continue to climax for, you know, 5-10 minutes, right? Even a half, some women can climax for half an hour, almost one continuous orgasm, right? So, and it's, you know, it's a very stimulating talk. So, you know, it's like, so it, that's one reason it's a million dollar point. It's like you hit the jackpot when you hold that, and the orgasm is like nothing you ever had. Some.
Can you repeat how to find the point?
You want me to show you? No. Actually, it's real simple. You find your urethra, mm-hmm. right? Which is, you can feel when the penis is erect, it shows, and you follow it back to where it enters into the perineum. Mm-hmm. You push your finger in there. There's actually a hole there, so your finger will go in, mm-hmm. right? Now the trick is, you don't want to be too vigorous because you'll injure the urethra. So if you're really pushing on that, it's like, you know, it's like sore, right? It's not the prostate that's sore, it's your urethra that's sore. So you have to have a certain tone. It takes practice.
Well, what's the point?
Well, the point is, the point is to retain your, to cultivate your sexual energy, retain your sexual fluids, and circulate them around the body to rejuvenate the organs and the brain, etc. Actually, the point is to be enlightened. Okay? So, by developing the qing, which is the sexual energy, that's the energy part, but by developing the sexual fluids in the body, you not only rejuvenate the body, so it has, so to speak, have high, good testosterone levels, but it helps cultivate the brain's experience of, you know, create soma, or ojas, or amrita in the Sanskrit term. The Chinese term, they just talk about cultivating, making the brain brighter and stronger that way. And then you get
the golden flower, that's how it's called.
Well, yes, yes. Although it starts with the heart in that position, but the actual chemical structure, they just talk about the brain. They don't talk about what it's cultivating. We're going to get to the ojas and the soma and the amrit and the tantric portion. Okay. So,
Do you have comments along the way too, or questions, or not?
Oh, actually, please interact. Family style's good.
Well, I think you described with putting pressure on your reason, it can be done mentally too, right?
Actually, that's part of the 99% technique, right? So you actually do it not just mentally, but you can move the muscles to tighten up. And then they hold the hand, the thumbs, they tighten the toes. They put the teeth together, put the tongue against the roof of the mouth, and stop the flow of qing, so it doesn't leave the body, right? Now, the qing can also leave the body as it's circulating in a subtle form. So you can have a heart orgasm, or an orgasm in your, you know, pineal gland, and between your partners, so it will jump from one partner to the next partner, and you can feel orgasm. So the energy will actually, you know, the hearts will open, or the you know, the navel chakra, manipura will open, and you'll have orgasm in different chakras. There are also many other minor chakras. So the whole, the different chakra energy centers can start to, the energy can pass for one another, pass from one another subtly, but it's physical. It's not like there's not a fluid, but there's an energy, and it's completely physical. The other person will respond as if they're having an orgasm in their heart, as you're having an orgasm with your heart. Okay. So,
can your brain have an orgasm?
The brain, the pineal gland can do it too. Actually, the crown chakra can do it too. You can have mutual. If we ever get there, I have a crown chakra orgasm, at least. Image, right? So, and all this stuff, you know, once you're interested in this stuff, you can find that it's all over the net these days. It's not like you have to find Mantak Chia and his disciples and buy these special books. No, you can go on, and if you just pay attention, somebody will post something about this type of thing. Okay. Any questions about the Taoist thing? Is very simple and easy to practice. Any questions about that?
It's a lot of questions, but I don't know where to stop.
Well, don't try. Anything come up?
Well, I'd like to know if something come up.
There are a lot of things. Okay. So, if you feel free to just jump in with whatever you think. So, the okay. Where am I going? Okay. Next, I'm gonna skip. So, we're gonna leave the Taoist approach. That's simple Taoism. If you read, the Secret of the Golden Flower and all the imagery, and so that's actually what Jung got hooked on in 1928, and he decided, well, then he didn't have to just be an ordinary psychiatrist. He could talk about all this archetypal stuff to the rest of the world, because he now had a way to do it by following the Taoist masters, that wrote the Secret of the Golden Flower. And he thought, well, obviously other people think this way, like I do, right? So it's just not my own craziness, right? It's actually symbolized in a lot of these traditional Taoist texts. So Richard Wilhelm brought this to him, and he got started, he attributes that to his ability to actually do archetypal psychiatry, or bring it to the world. So this Taoism is pretty important. Whether Jung practiced Taoism, I don't know, but he and Tony Wolf did some pretty interesting things together. and they spent a lot of time doing them. And they definitely studied various Buddhist meditation techniques and other things like this. It might come out, you never know. It's amazing what's been released so far. Okay, tantrism. So, the tantric stuff, we're getting to real juju here, okay? So this is very similar to, witch doctor things. The tantrics can do things for magic. They can use this energy to manifest things. They can use this energy to heal people. They can use this energy to make things disappear, hurt people, kill people. Right? So it's like being a curandero or a brujo, right? So if you're a good shaman, you heal people. If you're a bad shaman, you're awesome, right? And they do different things to get the energy, whether it's sacrificing chickens or doing particular dances or using herbs or whatever, or taking psychedelics, they get into this. The Cherokee Nation practiced a form of tantrism, and it was simpler, a little bit more like Taoism, but there was a similar tradition in the Native American tribes. It might be throughout the tribes, we really don't know, that hasn't come out yet. However, the tribes did come across from Asia, and so the Dalai Lama does joint ceremonies with the Hopi, because they have the same ceremonies, because it's the same tribe from Tibet. They came across before the Buddhists got there, but the Bon tradition and the Tibet Buddhist tradition are practically, they're practically the same, somewhat mirror image, because the Bon goes, does their thing to the left, and the Buddhists do their things on the right type stuff, but otherwise the rituals and the mantras are essentially the same, right? The Bon is a little more shamanistic in terms of animal sacrifice and more juju, more like the curandero and the brujo than the Tibetans, but the Tibetans do that, the Buddhists do that as well. So they don't talk about putting bones in people's temples and stuff like that, but they do stuff like that. So, and if it came over the bridge, probably the Mongols, the Bons, the Hopi, and the Laps are all one tribe. One tradition goes back 18,000 years, and they've been practicing these techniques. Yab-yam, which is, you've all seen the deities, you know, sitting in lotus and embrace and ecstasy type of thing, with all types of energies or other gods coming out of their heads or openings like that. So that's traditional Bon. That's traditional Tibetan Buddhist. You don't see that a lot in Buddhism today, but back before the Muslim invasion, there were a lot of sexual practices. In fact, a lot of the Brahmins used to say the reason the Buddhists aren't here is because they're degenerate, right? They were too free and having free love, free sex, and all this sort of stuff. Well, you know, I bet that's probably just because the Muslims chased them up north, right? Up valley, so to speak. So the tantric tradition is relatively the one that's current today in India is relatively recent, it's sort of medieval. It's related to Kali cults, it's also related to Sati. So we're coming back to Sati and the and when she immolated herself. So Shiva was doing the Tandava, or the dance of destruction. He was so angry he's going to destroy the world, right? So he's dancing around with Sati, and it burned Sati in his arms, and the world's starting to fall apart, and Vishnu, the preserver, takes his discus and cuts Sati up into 108 pieces. They like 108. different moon positions, right? 108. And they fall in different places. Different parts of Sati fall in different places. Well, one of them falls in Assam. And the woman I study with is the saint of Kamakya, the seat of Kama, the stan of Kama, the Shakti Peeth, or the seat of Shakti, which is the seat of desire. Which you can imagine what part of the female anatomy was. It's the vulva and the vagina, right? And it actually menstruates once a year, right? Fluids come out in June and go down the river, and the whole area turns, the whole river basin turns red. So it's a big deal, right? And you don't see it, there are no pictures of this on the web. You can see a picture of the temple from the outside, but they don't have any pictures of this esoteric stuff. The Hindus give people a hard time that betray some of their secrets, and they actually go at it with a vengeance. So there are none of these images on the web, although it's well known. You can read about it on Wikipedia, but you can't see it. Right? So they worship the vulva, they worship the vagina, and they actually have various pujas, homas, etc., that go with that.
Sorry, you're talking about Sita? Because you said Sati. Sita, is it Sita?
Sati.
Sati.
Sati. Sita is Ram's wife. Sati was Shiva's first wife. So women in India used to perform Sati when their husband died and they didn't want to be widowers because there was, you know, they have to depend on the family and they're just a burden. So they jump in the funeral fire with their husband, or self-immolate themselves after Sati, who immolated herself when Shiva was humiliated. He didn't die.
Who's Shiva's wife?
So Shiva's wife. Parvati was his second wife. Right? So and Parvati's where the erotic impulse got loose. Right? So that's more this Kali Yuga period. So in the golden age, people could reproduce just by thinking about it. You know, the gods came out of their head or their loins or whatever, that type of stuff. So we have to reproduce. So we need the desire. It has to be everywhere to make everything grow. So the tantric approach is Very similar to the Taoist, except you put a lot of mantras and a lot of rituals, and a lot of flowers and different ointments, and you basically treat one another as a deity. So you do a puja, or worship, to your partner. Right? And you do it, you do it to their sexual organs, okay? So the woman may do a puja to not just the lingam in like the temple, all this stuff on the stone, they actually do it on the penis. They put all the five things on the penis and the and you know, they draw little faces on it and they put flowers on, right? This is part of it, right? Which is, it's a little complicated, right? But it's essentially the same thing that they do publicly to the Shiva Lingam, they do privately to the male sexual organ. And the man worships, I think someone put up an image of the goddess, you know, splayed with her vagina showing, right? Recently in one of the talks. But there's several images like this. And it's a common image in Tantrism to worship and actually do the same thing to the vagina, the vulva. So, you know, flowers, ointments, you know, milk, honey, ghee, all that sort of stuff. And with puja, you're basically doing puja to, or worshiping, you know, the female genitalia, the female, the yoni, the vulva, the vagina, like that. And there are chants that go with this, and there are mantras that go with this, and there are hand movements that go with it, right, mudras. And depending on where you're going to go with it, so to speak, if you're actually having sex to have a child, there's another set of rituals that you do, right? To actually have the sperm blessed and the ova blessed at the time you're having intercourse. So, you know, the whole part of it, from the external to the entry, you know, penetration, it's all related to certain mantras, and it's relatively a tedious way to have sex. It's not like, it's certainly not, you know, paradoxical where you're not trying. It's very ritualized. I don't find that terribly erotic myself to do all these procedures. It sounds really erotic. I mean, to think of all these rituals being done, you know, and people, you know, doing stuff to the penis and the vagina and stuff. But it's like, it goes on. If you've ever gone to Hindu ceremony, they go on for hours. I mean, the Shiva puja goes on for hours. I mean, how the guy keeps an erection, that, I mean, they have to sort of, you know, himself keep going. You know. And the vagina, it's easier, but it still goes on for hours, right? And whether the woman's aroused is another. After a while, it's like, okay, come on, get it over. Right? Let's finish this. Can you cut it out a little bit? Can we skip that section? So, okay. And this is all top secret. You will not find this in most... If you go to any Hindu text on the web, you're not going to find this. It is there. I mean, you can find that. In Kali Puja, these things are there. How to worship the vagina is in there. How to conceive the child's in there. Shiva Puja, in the fine print, they'll tell you how to worship the lingam, the male, you know, the penis, that sort of stuff. But nobody's saying, you know, this is the way to worship the penis, or this is the way to worship the vagina. It's completely discreet.
So,
Right? So, and naturally in India, they're probably ever, you know, the correct pronunciation of a mantra changes every 10 miles, because that's as far as they can get in a day. Right? So, if people say, oh, you know, you're not chanting properly, then it might be just from a different district, right? And of course, if you don't chant properly, then you don't get any good effects, but you're doing it the way you learn, right? So the tantra will change from area to area, and of course, some of them get quite exotic and actually quite, not only do you have animal sacrifice, but you could have human sacrifice, right? I mean, that existed went under British rule for a while. They were called Duggies, right? And it was a Kali cult, and they were thought to offer human heads, human arms, all this sort of stuff. And they would abduct Brits or Indians for this type of thing. That's sort of the dark side. Those are the black magicians. Yes.
What time was this related?
It was still going on in the 19th century.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Yeah, there are texts in the 19th century talking about this. Mm-hmm. Right?
This is left Ken Tantra.
What?
Left Ken Tantra.
No, yeah, the black Tantra.
White Tantra or right Ken Tantra and left Tantra or black Tantra?
Well, it would be black. It's for black magic. Yes.
Yeah. So white tantra has nothing to do with sex.
With
white tantra, right hand tantra has nothing to do with sex. It's a self-realization through the body, but not necessarily sex.
Well, I would disagree. There's actually white tantra, which is also sex.
British corrupted the word tantra and used it as. Sex, as
okay.
They include a lot of
that's a very good point. That's a very good point. Tantra is not just sex. Tantra is everything. Tantra is weaving. The word tantra means weaving. So yeah. So it's yantra, mantra, and tantra is actually the spiritual tradition. Yantra are the things you draw, right? The stars and the mandalas. That's yantras, right? So sacred images, like the Hopis draw, sacred images, the same idea. Mantras are the sacred words, which have multiple meanings depending on your tradition and what level you're going on.
I don't know what the remote control is.
We have it now?
Yes.
Oh, we have it.
Yes, we...
Now if we can
wait,
get
wait,
that.
Wait a bit.
Okay.
We only
I'm getting excited.
We only have the text. The photos were too large.
Oh, okay.
That's why the presentation couldn't be shared.
Oh, okay.
So we only have the text, but we can share the
We'll do the text. The photos were, you know, obviously that's some talking point, but that's okay. Yes, go ahead. Yes. Tantra means weaving. Weaving. So a tantric tradition includes everything. So everything can be a means of meditation. Everything can be a means of liberation. What you eat, how you eat it, how you pee, how you poo, how you walk, they refine everything. It gets extremely ritualized. However, I would disagree that, you know, sex is just left hand, it's also right hand. The tantric tradition, Shaktism, without the black magic, also uses sex to cultivate the energy. Like the Taoists. So there are tantric, you know, in Shaktism, the worship of the woman, the worship of the Shakti, the worship of sexual energy is also practiced. It's just not practiced with, and actually it is practiced with killing animals. So they will kill goats. This is Kali cults, but they definitely sacrifice the goats and they eat the meat. It's not the vegetarian Hindu stuff, right? So Ramakrishna was a Kali cult priest. And initially he was very Brahmin and wouldn't eat the meat and cooked his own food, but eventually he ate everything. Right? He ate the goat meat, he ate pork, he ate everything, you know, he practiced all this stuff. So and that's very tantric. Mm-hmm. And so the Ramakrishna mission comes across. You know, the Vivekananda stuff comes across very intellectual and dry, but Ramakrishna was not that way at all. He was extremely ballsy and crude and rude and participated in this whole thing, including he had a tantrika as his guru, who had naked women come in. He didn't have sex with them, at least according to the tradition. When they got on his lap, he would go into ecstasy. And he would worship prostitutes as Mother Divine. He would actually take the dust from their feet, you know, even though the whole village, you know, thought they were nasty women, right? But they would take the dust from them. He worshiped them as Mother Divine. He saw them as pure incarnation of Shakti, right? So that, and that's tantrism, pure and simple. So, very simple, right? And that's worshiping everything as divine, right? And so that's the tantric approach. These are relatively superficial renditions of this, so we're not turning you into a tantrika, not turning you into a shakta, not turning you into a Taoist, but giving you an idea of the idea of the cultivation of the energy. So I think we're all familiar with the idea of bringing the kundalini up through the chakras, and that can be done during sex. There are lots of seminars, you know, that go into that. How much of, you know, there's Zen tantric seminars, right? There's, I traveled with a fellow in old Tibet, in Lahal Spiti, who was both a geshe and a tantric master. And he taught the Tibetan approach to tantric sex, but it was very secret. He didn't have, like, you know, fancy ads with, you know, tantra, you know. It was all, it's only for the Buddhist tantra, Buddhist Tibetan groups, you know, he would do that. We left him in Spiti in a cave where he spent 10 days. Because the energy, if you have electricity, the energy isn't that good. So you have to practice the subtler tantric practices or Tibetan Buddhist practices in totally natural settings without electricity, certainly no Wi-Fi, no Bluetooth, all that sort of stuff. Yes?
I have a question. After listening to Stuart Sobatsky and listening to all these talks,
yeah.
I was talking to someone that for me and also for other people, the same question arises. What is sex then, you know, in this bigger context? And what's a sexual experience?
It's the same at all levels. So the sexual orgasm is the mind stops. So you have a moment of satori or samadhi. If you have a full orgasm, if you just have, you know, the body has a little orgasm, but you're not there, you're not in ecstasy. There's no, that's not what we think of as orgasm. That's some type of, you know, just physical release. When you have an orgasm, the mind stops. And when the mind stops, generally you have consciousness without content, satori, samadhi, turiya. So one of the most ordinary, and there's stories about this in India all the time. So, you know, the great yogi has been practicing yoga and has developed all these cities, magical powers. So he can, you know, he can walk across water, he can, you know, burn birds by looking at them, but they disturb him, you know, they get, and he goes into town and, you know, talks to the butcher's wife, who tells him his whole life story and then proceeds to, you know, tell him where he went wrong. And all she was doing is having sex with her husband, right? So, you know, and the butcher was the lowest caste in Hindu. I mean, you know, the Hindus eat meat if you're a kshatriya or a shudra, if you do like a warrior or you do manual labor. So, and then the lowest part, the most outcast part of those castes was the butcher. So the butcher's wife can be more enlightened than these yogis with magic powers, right? Simply because from devotion, from paying attention, from having sex like that, from cultivation. So obviously these rituals didn't exist. Probably Taoism didn't exist. You know, probably Hinduism and all that Vedic stuff didn't exist 100,000 years ago. But we were still having sex, and people were still getting enlightened, and people were still in altered states. And, you know, the San people have, you know, the descriptions of all that. And they came up with language and symbols through altered states induced by trance dance, induced by sex. But what they do, I'm not privy to, right? How they did it, and indeed, to what goes on today, the San people are pretty much abused. You got that?
No.
Okay. Nothing. Okay. No problem. All right. So no audio video. Okay. So Mercury must be having a good time. Any questions on the idea that sexual orgasm is actually a spiritual experience? I think we all know that.
Yeah? There is this book of Jenny Wade. Yeah?
What?
Jenny Wade. Jenny Wade.
Okay.
Teacher, no?
I don't know Jenny Wade's book.
Jenny Wade. Is your name Jenny Wade? It has a book about transpersonal sex. And it's about the research he made about people having transpersonal experiences and spiritual experiences during sex.
Yes. Absolutely.
I don't remember exactly the name. You know how is the name, Stephen? Jenny Wade?
Yeah, Jenny Wade.
Jenny Wade. Yeah. I haven't read her research. But I agree with it entirely.
She find that even the medicators have the most mystical experiences sometimes during sex.
Because they've probably cultivated their chakras or their subtle energies a little bit more. However, that doesn't mean that, you know, 13, 14 year olds in other cultures without any of this background won't have extremely spiritual experiences when they're ripe at having sex, right? In fact, the whole idea of not having sex or intercourse till after 18 is something extremely Western. Most cultures start to have sex when they have puberty. Right? I mean, that's when you go through the rituals. 12, 13, 14 years old. Bam! Now you're going to have your own family or whatever. Or at least you're going to have sex for a while. Then you'll decide who to have your family with. That type of thing. Right? So, like that. So, okay, so sex is, where was I going with this in my slide deck? Sex is the ability to reconcile not only the masculine and feminine bodily, right? But the individual, if you think of your nervous system as, you know, the brain and the vertebra as if it's its own sexual channel, right? And when the energy comes into the crown chakra and opens, then you reunite with the mother or the father, depending on how, you can look at it either way you want. So the crown chakra opens and the consciousness expands infinitely. So you have an experience of a moment of non-duality, a moment of satori, a moment of samadhi. And you may or may not be able to recognize that because there's no thoughts. But if the physiology is cultivated, and or if you happen to be, your physiology was naturally that way because you had good stars or good karma, whatever you want to call it, you fall into it like that. It's like spontaneous, right? So you not only fall into it, but you can stay there. So you actually stay in the state of orgasm. I'm going to turn this off. Stay in the state of orgasm. What happened? Okay. Stay in the state of orgasm 24/7. That doesn't work. I'll have to hold it. Stay in the state of orgasm 24/7. So you are actually uniting with the cosmic being, right? So the unio mystica is uniting with the cosmos, with God, and the idea is not to come down. Teresa of Avila talks about when the one flame, when your one flame enters into the universal flame, and it all becomes one. And it doesn't stop, right? And Teresa of Avila's period of time was heavily influenced by the Sufis and the Muslims. That's part of where they got the erotic quality of the spiritual practices, right? But because of the whole beloved thing, right? So John of the Cross experienced God as a woman, right? And God had sex with him. So in Teresa of Avila's time, this was fairly common to have, at least among the mystical group, to have, religious group, to have the experience of not just orgasm, but orgasm, you know, where you sort of get lifted off the bed, but you get lifted off completely. I mean, they will levitate in it, ecstasy, right? So not only ecstasy, but they float, they fly. Teresa had, I think, 5 convents with over 200 nuns, and 80% of them levitated. It wasn't unusual. It's recorded, it's history. It's not like you have to go, no, this is unfair. It's recorded. Thomas Aquinas, who wrote most of the spiritual dialogues for at least the West for a long time, and is still, you know, sort of the doctor of the church, spent 2 hours in midair, about 4 feet above the ground, one Sunday afternoon, and never wrote again. He said it's all chaff. Right?
It's all what? Chaff?
Chaff. It's all chaff. It's all rubbish.
Uh-huh.
It's all rubbish, right?
Who you say, Thomas?
Thomas Aquinas.
Thomas Aquinas.
Yeah, Thomas Aquinas thought all his writing was chaff.
All his writing was just rubbish?
It was rubbish. It does not compare at all. Plato, I'm winding up here. So Plato, in the Phaedo, has Socrates talking with Diotima. I think Diotima may have been mentioned, I don't know if he was, it wasn't this. Diotima is who we get the Western tradition of philosophy from. And she was a prostitute in Athens. She was a courtesan. And she was Socrates' teacher. Okay? I mean, I just love this stuff. I mean, and that's very tantric. I mean, you know, this, and she describes the sea of beauty. And the sea of beauty, we started off with Venus coming out of the ocean. The sea of beauty is Venus in the ocean. That's the sea of beauty, or sex. Right? The peak experience of sex, right? The orgasm of sex. That's the sea of beauty. You can enter it. They may have entered it with the Kekion and, you know, cultivated it in their rituals and Eleusis and the Orphic rituals. All that's true. However, it was actually this sea of beauty, which was love, which was the highest wisdom for the Platonists, who we generally think of as non-sexual,
mm-hmm.
Right? So, but they got it from a prostitute in Athens. Right? How to be sexually non-sexual, or non-sexually sexual? I'm not sure. It's very paradoxical,
mm-hmm.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
So when someone comes enlightened, they have no, first of all, in Bodhisattva, in the Eric Erickson level of generativity, right, you're naturally generous. There are actually genes for that. Robert Cloninger has genes for each of these stages that get activated, and he describes the psychology that goes along exactly with Eric Erickson and Ken Wilber. So it's sequential. You can have peak experiences before that. You can obviously have a sexual orgasm before you get to, you know, enlightenment, but it's like it's a bill. The genetics unfold, so you can't have intimacy, if you haven't dealt with your genital phases or gone through a good latency and not had oral or anal issues, right? You can't have generativity without having had intimacy. Because actually generativity is intimacy with your community. This is what I said earlier, right? So, that to have the true flowering of your sexuality is to actually have generativity where you no longer are selfish. It's totally love. You perform out of love. You're a bodhisattva. Everything is not because you need it. You may want it, but you don't need it. You want to help. You want to give. Growing up Catholic, I thought, well, when you got there, then you probably didn't have sex anymore, right? Because you're totally fulfilled. You know, and all these nuns were like, you know, want to slap your hand with a ruler, that type of stuff. So, but it's not true. You know, so, and when you get into non-duality, it's like everything is just sex. Everything is just pure orgasm. Every touch, every sight, every sound, every smell, every taste, it's just one wave of ecstatic bliss. Wave of wave of bliss. Right? It's all bliss. And it's continuous bliss. So it just stays. And some people have that experience and come down from it. Actually, Cloninger in his book talks about Emerson having the experience of non-duality and coming down and coming back up again and coming down. Thoreau stayed there. Right? Krishnamurti stays there. So I got turned onto this with Krishnamurti and Stan Grof, you know, back in 1970, and I thought, of course, Krishnamurti would be like, you know, totally self-sufficient, and you know, he wouldn't be, you know, wouldn't be a sexual creature. Wrong, right? Krishnamurti every week, once a week. I mean, he wasn't, you know, wasn't having sex a lot. Actually, in Ayurveda, they describe celibacy as sex every 3 days. That's the definition of being celibate, having sex every 3 days. More than that, you're not celibate, you know? Literally, that's it. And it's to cultivate ojas, so we haven't gotten there yet. But, so, you know, Krishnamurti would show up at this woman's place. This woman was married, right? Her husband was practicing total celibacy. He thought he was going to be some type of yoga. Of course, Krishnamurti was already there, right? He would show up with a flower and come in and they'd have sex for the afternoon or evening. The husband knew about it because she wanted to have, you know, he wasn't having sex with her. She wanted to have sex with Krishnamurti. So he did that for decades, right?
The same.
Once a week. Okay. So the idea in practicing Ayurvedic celibacy or Taoist retention techniques is the cultivation of the sexual fluids, sexual energies, which in Ayurveda there are seven tissues. So you eat something and it turns into some rasa or chyle, gets absorbed, turns into blood, and that goes into various stages of digestion, and eventually, it goes through, you know, like muscle and fat and bone marrow and brain, and finally it gets to sexual material. Yes.
Did I understand you right that celibacy is just the other side of sexuality?
Celibacy?
Yes.
Oh well. You can. I mean, you don't have to have sex to get enlightened. But there's no reason you don't have to not have sex to get enlightened too. Right? However, cultivating the sexual fluids, it seems to be part of it, at least in Ayurveda. And the way this goes is that the sexual fluid, shukra, the reason they practice any type of celibacy is to hold the shukra, the sexual fluids, and then the meditative practices naturally it volatilizes and comes up into the heart, actually. So shukra turns into ojas or soma in the heart. And if you have 8 drops of soma, you're alive, and if you have more than that, you start to have elevated consciousness. Okay? So then your consciousness expands, and soma is the first psychedelic. Right? So it's based on a creeper, a green, like ayahuasca. Right? They actually still have it. It's not the mushroom that they've talked about. So it's a creeper, still there. As it grows on the mountainsides, they can prepare it. But you have your internal soma as well, which just does the same thing, puts you into altered states. They don't talk about DMT, they talk about soma. Soma is supposed to be excreted on the skin. Soma is supposed to be in your gonads. Soma is supposed to be in your brain. Mm-hmm. And it's the chemical of consciousness. So the whole idea of cultivating sexual energy and love is to elevate your consciousness, and then the consciousness itself basically becomes bliss or love, becomes enlightened. So the chemical of consciousness, the chemical of enlightenment, natural physiological enlightenment is soma. We can stimulate that with psychedelics, or we can stimulate that with breath work or whatever, or different techniques. But when we do the techniques, we're stimulating our own soma. When we're, at least in the Ayurvedic tradition, we might be, say, DMT or something like that in a Western tradition. But it's the subtle feel is soma, and you can actually feel soma in your pulse. Or at least pulse diagnosticians can feel that. They can also feel, the Chinese ones can feel your qi and your qing in their pulse, right? So it's palpable. It's palpable. It's actually something, it's physiological. So the physiology of enlightenment, the physiology of being naturally loving, not just with one or two people, but with everybody, entirely, can be cultivated either by naturally just mating with someone and being sort of having some kind of true passion with them, or by practicing these techniques and being passionate with them, or just by practicing these techniques and being passionate for God, right? And even when you achieve complete non-duality, you may still be having sex with your partners, because the body has its, as Ken Kesey said in the electrocholate acid test, it's all a movie. Just watch the movie. You don't do anything, you just sit back and watch the whole thing unfold. So your body will continue to do what bodies do. Whether or not, no matter what your philosophical orientation, your body is still going to want to have sex. It's one of those appetites that you're built for. I mean, one of the biggest things is gender stuff. We identify ourselves mostly by gender. Some people are bisexual, some people, might be somewhat asexual, but they're still sexual, right? And so it's part of the natural behavior, our tendency of the body. So the body behaves by itself when you're enlightened, when you're in bodhisattva, when you're non-dual, but you do it for totally different reasons. It's not selfish, right? It's not that you have to get your orgasm or get your nut or get your whatever. It's because it's sharing the bliss and the wave of the bliss and loving one another through that. So, and Plato in the Phaedo, Diotima describes this sea of beauty, and that it is love, and that it is all wisdom and all joy and all bliss. And she says, there's nothing wrong with, I'm missing the exact Greek word because I don't have my slides, but she says, and there's nothing, untoward or wrong with that, is there, Socrates? Right? So there's not, in other words, there's nothing wrong with this cultivation of love, cultivation of sexual energy, cultivation of knowledge through the outcome. this conscious awareness, which does give you mystical knowledge. It gives you knowledge not only mystical, it gives you knowledge of absolutely everything, if you wish to know it. You can just watch it. You can tune into anything, like you're tuning your TV in the old days. You can turn into any channel, see, touch, feel, taste, anything. There is a, I know a couple of people who have had this experience and written it up. There's a book by Susan Siegel, she didn't understand what was happening. I think it's called Collision with the Infinite, and I know her pretty well, and I know her boyfriend pretty well, and she got pregnant with her boyfriend, and her boyfriend wanted to be a monk for the Maharishi, and went, you know, even though she was still having sex, but you know, he wanted to be a monk. So he didn't want to get married, even though she was pregnant, and so she got pissed and said, oh, well, you know, screw you and screw Maharishi, I'm just going to go off to Paris. Maybe I'll investigate the Buddhist things in Paris. And she goes and she steps on a bus in Paris and pop. She got enlightened, just letting go of everything, letting go of her boyfriend, letting go of, you know, her spiritual path, letting go, her consciousness just expanded, and she became completely dissociated. 24/7, she's witnessing everything, watching the movie. She actually got rich. She went to some psychologist because she didn't understand what was going on. She went to some psychologist in the Bay Area who wrote her up as a case example of dissociation. Front of the book, you know, I think they even had her name in there. One of the Yoga Journal editors read it, said, this isn't dissociation. This is Zen. This is Shan. This is being in the heart. So he found her. He said, you know, this is, read these texts. Is this what's going on? He says, yeah. So, you know, yeah, okay. So she became a teacher at the Zen Center, Green Gulch, for a while. And then she had a following. She has sort of a website that's still kept up, even though she's dead now. And before she died, the Yoga Journal editor said, you have to write this up. So, with reluctance, she wrote up her personal journey, exactly how she'd experienced all these things, and how it was behaving in this state. And we think it's a big deal to interact with one another and, you know, touch and hug or have sex or whatever. And she says the psychologists just don't get it. She says it's way more fun. You're way more alive when you can experience what everyone's touching, what everyone's tasting, what everyone's seeing, what everyone's hearing, what everyone's feeling, whatever, taste, touch, I've not missed a sense. But basically, when you're in that non-dual state, you're not just you, you're everybody, everywhere, including the animals, including the rocks and the stones, and you're enjoying the whole damn thing, right? And it's all nothing but love. A wave of love.
What is the name of this guy?
That's Susan Siegel. And actually that's on her website. Susan Siegel, S-E-G-A-L. Suzanne Siegel. Suzanne Siegel. And you'll find her on the web, it's maintained. And there are quotes like that. Her book is called The Collision with the Infinite, or Collision with Infinity, or something like that. It's got a picture of a Buddha with its head knocked off, right? So like somebody ran into the Buddha and knocked his head off, right? So it's like, you know, it doesn't fit a form. It's beyond name and form.
The Krishnamurti you were talking about is Jiddu Krishnamurti?
Yeah, Jiddu Krishnamurti. The famous Jiddu Krishnamurti,
oh,
the teacher of non-dualism, you know.
I didn't know. Because in his book, the end, didn't make a big deal out of it when people...
He doesn't make a big deal. He tells, you know, people are just after sex, you know, the mind chasing its tail, you just want pleasure, you do this. He poo-poos the whole cognitive thing. He tries to break your mind with, you know, stopping the thinking.
Yeah.
The rest of it is consciousness doesn't really care.
Yeah.
Right? So, I don't know where my... Oh, there's a sign-in sheet? I don't have a sign-in sheet. But anyway, so question.
Yes, I have.
Yes.
I'm curious if you have like some recommendation that are like a kind of not rules but lines to follow. I mean that are more in harmony with the totality when it comes to the sexual experience. I mean not. I mean in general.
Rules to follow.
Not, it's not like rules, but things that are better than the other. I mean, not in the process. I mean, there are these principles, or I don't know. I'm just curious. What is
well,
your
the principles
idea?
Are that's cultural. Principles are cultural, so it's a cognitive frame. Depends on your culture and your background, and a lot of our cultural stuff is agrarian. And it has to do with possessions and who owns what property and who owns whom and who's going to inherit it. So it's very distorted. And you have to be very suspect of your own ideas because you got them from other people. We hardly ever have original ideas. So it's very suspect. Okay? All our ideas about sex, you know, true love, fidelity, you know, polygamy, polyandry, you know, polyamory, these are all ideas that are pretty much the result of enslaving one another.
I met
right?
A teacher recently, and he told to the audience that one of the reasons, metaphorically, the humanity fell from the Eden was because of sexual misconduct. And he, like, everything that you...
That's so agrarian. Okay? That's so agrarian, that's so possessive. Right? So the Yanomano... In the Amazon, the Yanomano was a tribe discovered in the, actually it was discovered in the 60s, but nobody really knew about them until like the 90s, right? So they're relatively pristine, and every woman has four husbands, and every husband has four wives. And so the whole tribe is intermarried. All the little groups are intermarried. So when it says it takes a tribe to raise, you know, it takes a tribe to raise a child, well, yeah, it did, because you don't know whose child it is, and it's, you know, there's no possession going on, right? So it's not, obviously they only had sex with people they wanted to have sex with, and that type of stuff, and there's, so it's still related to a type of romance or desire, but it's not, doesn't have to do with our, you're my boyfriend, you're my girlfriend, and I own you. And don't you dare cheat on me. There was no such thing as cheating in the Yanomano tribe. Right?
Yes, but what about the...
And that's true for a lot of the tribes in Africa are very similar, unless they've been westernized. I'm sorry.
No, I'm sorry. I'm curious, what about the sacredness of this? I mean, if you have multiple partners, mm-hmm. The energies are mixing. It's not a purity. It's like a cocktail.
Yes.
It's like a cocktail. Absolutely. Absolutely.
Absolutely.
But if you have multiple partners at the same time or sequentially, it's the same idea. In fact, let's get a little more specific. You not only carry their energy, you carry their cells. There's microcolonization that happens not only with your sexual partners, but everybody that has massaged you or touched you, their cells actually enter your body and colonize you, and they're part of you. So, yes, it's all true. Whether that's good or bad, you know, I really don't think I know. I don't know. However, it's like, and it's also the same idea with the microbiome. You know, we think, oh, DNA is our DNA. No, we should, 90 to 99%, depending on which person you're reading in this thing now, 90 to 99% of our DNA is not ours. We borrow it from the bacteria, from the protozoa, from one another, and so we're actually social beings. And if we didn't have that, children that come out, that come from cesarean, don't have the vaginal fluids, right? And they have an impacted immune system. So if you don't have that microbiome, you don't have the right genetics to interact. So whether that makes you weaker or stronger, I don't know. But quite frankly, the colonization and sharing energy happens all, you know, you get on the bus and you hold the rail that somebody just let go of, you're just getting colonized by the, some of the cells and bacteria they just left. Right? You're sitting next to somebody and they're breathing and you're breathing and you breathe in some of the, what they, their exhaust. You just get colonized by them. Right? Literally, not just with carbon dioxide and oxygen, but literally with colonies. Right? So we're very social beings. And the whole pasteurization, right, of making things sterile might be why we have so many diseases now that are things like obesity and different cancers that didn't, there were still cancers back before Pasteur, but they weren't as common. Well, people died early. No, actually people lived just as long then if they survived childhood. Right? The trouble is surviving childhood. You know, once you developed your immune system, you'd live to 80, 90 years old. That was probably common. No big deal. Just like today. We say, our life expectancy is so much longer. That's just because they included infant mortality in it. Right? So it's a total medical, total contemporary medical con to say that they've extended our lifestyle, our life cycle. It's wrong. You know, Socrates was in his 80s. Plato lived in his 80s. How come? They didn't have modern medicine. They used garlic for infections, You know what I'm talking about? It's like ridiculous. Anyway, what time is it? I have a sense.
Yes, it's dinner time.
Oh my God, it's 9 o'clock? Okay. Thank you very much. Hey, thanks for staying so long.
Thank you.